See, up to now, we studied about steam turbines. Now we will talk about hydro turbine. The reason why I wanted to introduce, though, you know, we don't have hydro turbines, is basically because we have to do some integrated studies in which hydro turbines are there. For example, Tata Electric has got almost 600, 700 megawatts. Then Koina, etc. They are big. And even out of your own interest, hydro turbines are little interesting. Of course, this is a schematic diagram of a hydroelectric power plant. You've got a generator turbine, but here the working fluid is water, and it is coming from the forebay, and then this is the huge penstock, and this is the, it's like a, maybe some two-story building wicket gate. It's not as simple as I just drawn as this one. It's a huge one. Is it these penstocks? You see that one? It may be, you know, it's monstrous penstocks, maybe dropping 1 kilometer something. And this is a huge dam. I don't know whether you visited any of any hydroelectric power plants. It's really worth visiting. Now, the funniest part of the hydroelectric power, this one turbine, hydro turbine, is that, let's say that you open the gate, you know, you want to increase the power, no? Like, for example, in the case of a steam turbine, if you want to increase the power, you open the control valves. Similarly, here, if you want to increase the power, let's say you open the gate. Therefore, let's say that you give a 1 per unit change in gate position, no? You open the gate. But the mechanical power output for the turbine, if you see, initially, it actually goes down. Okay? And then slowly, gradually increases. Okay? This is the absolute peculiarity of a hydro turbine. Of course, any hydro turbine, I will tell you what is the reason for it, is that whenever you open the gate, etc., initially the power output will come down and then gradually increase, and then it will increase. Therefore, initially delta PM goes negative, after a time delay it goes to positive. Now, this is basically because of, you know, water is a very inelastic medium. It is basically because the water inertia is used to cause changes in turbine flow to lag behind changes in turbine gate opening. When the gate is suddenly open, the flow does not change immediately due to water inertia. The flow will not change. But the pressure, because you open the gate, the pressure across the turbine is reduced, etc. The mechanical power output is proportional to the product of pressure and flow. Flow has not changed, but the pressure comes down. Therefore, the mechanical power output initially decreases. This is actually called the water time constant. Therefore, if you see, this is one of the things which you have to give in PSC for hydroelectric modeling. Hydro turbine modeling, you have to give the water time constant, etc. And with the response time determined by this, the water accelerates until the flow reaches a new steady state value, which establishes new steady state power output. Basically, this coming down and then slowly increasing is basically because of the water inertia. This is a peculiarity to the hydro turbine. Similarly, let's say that you close the turbine, you know, you close the gate, but once you close the gate, the reverse happens. Initially, actually, the power output goes up and then gradually it comes down. Initially, delta PM goes positive, then the delta Pm reduces. Okay? The reverse happens. This is actually the peculiarity of a hydroturbine. That's the reason why in hydroturbine, this is the steam turbine, this is the droop. RP is the droop that we have got. That usually 3%, 4%, 5%, 6%, etc. But in addition to that, because the water inertia, what you have to, these are available in PSS model, etc. This is called the temporary droop. Temporary droop is usually between 20 to 50%. That's a value. Whereas the permanent droop is only 4 to 5%. Therefore, of course, more the droop, less it is. This one, no? It will react. It will become sluggish. Hydro turbine have a peculiar response to water inertia. A change in gate position produces initial turbine output which is opposite to that. For stable control system performance, a large transient droop with a long resetting time is therefore required. This is accompanied with a provision of rate feedback of transient gain reduction component. It retards the limit of the gate movement until the water flow and power output have time to catch up. The result is a governor which exhibits a high droop, low gain for fast speed deviations, a normal low droop in the steady state. So you can, in nutshell, for example, if the hydro station is operating in islanded mode, etc., this droop is set very high, the temporary droop. But when it's parallel with the grid, etc., usually it is set at 20%. Therefore, whenever you are doing a PSSC model, etc., maybe 20%, 30%, that the transient droop setting you can keep it for this. And the normal droop setting will be same, typical 4 to 5%. But this temporary droop setting you will have to give for hydro turbines. Now, this is one thing, this is a, if I go to any college, this is a standard question I ask, which one responds very fast, etc. Steam turbine or a hydro turbine? And everybody says hydro. Everybody says hydro, etc. Actually, for a sudden change, if you see, hydro turbine is the slowest, etc. The next is steam turbine with a reheater. This is the steam turbine with the reheater, and the fastest is steam turbine without, that is no reheat. But no reheat steam turbines are only for 100 megawatts and below. See, all steam turbines, 200 megawatt, 500, 600 megawatt, or down units, they will always have reheat. But what I am saying is that these reheat turbines will always be, for example, a sudden load change comes, etc. A steam turbine can respond faster than a hydro turbine. See that? And why this confusion arises? People confuse this transient response with respect to, see, starting. For example, if the boiler has tripped, to get the unit back into service, it may take 8 hours, 4 hours. That is different. That steam turbine will take a long time. Hydro turbine, within 20 minutes, you can come back. But that is in, let's say, complete blackout, you want to restart the unit. But for traction response, actually, steam responds much faster than hydro. This is one of the things which people do not actually, sometimes confuse. I hope you understand, no? Maybe with, nowadays you may have some promotion interviews also. Somebody might ask this question. Somebody from generation will come. Now let us talk about the I think I finished the steam and the hydro, etc. If it's required, I have not yet got any slides for gas. I said, I will make some slides for gas and bring it to you. Now, let's now come to this, what they call system number. That's a very important thing in systems analysis, is that it is a composite regulating characteristic, a disturbance delta P, a load throw off or application, a small island system. If, for example, only if Danu is working, if you throw 20 megawatts load, etc., also, the change in frequency will be high. Change in frequency. But in very large interconnected systems, the change in frequency is very small. But it's very small, very large, etc., they are all very qualitative figures. Therefore, you have some numbers quantified. Therefore, the quantification of this is very precisely defined in power system analysis as stiffness number. And of course, in common parlance, it is called the system number. You know, system number kitna hai, western region ka. But actually, it's called stiffness. And I will tell you another term for it. The stiffness number of the system number beta is 1 by R equivalent plus D. By R equivalent is the regulation, that is hertz per megawatt. I will explain to you with the example. And D is the load damping. As I told you, if the frequency goes down, the load also corresponding goes down. There is a natural reduction in load. That's called the load damping. This stiffness number is 1 by R equivalent plus D. Now, of course, if you are attending some international seminars, etc., in some using beta is also called, for example, in IEEE North American, terminology is called AFRC, Area Frequency Response Characteristic. Of course, it's a very big term, but actual meaning is that it's a stiffness number. Now, in a small system, the stiffness number could be 100 megawatts per hertz. That means that to change 1 hertz, the load throw in or this one change should be 100 megawatts. Is it done? Now, if this is the system number, if actual load throw is 20 megawatts has changed, etc., the change in frequency will be 20 by 100, about 0.2 hertz it will change. But let's say it's a big system, into 100 I increase it 10 times, 1000 megawatts. Therefore, to change 1 hertz, I need 1000 megawatts. Therefore, the same 20 megawatt change, this one, if there is a change, the delta F actual change will be 20 by 1000, only 0.02 hertz, because system has become big. Are you with me? Yes. So now, I will give you a practical example also. For example, in 2011, 2 into 500 megawatts, that is a Dadri, 1000 megawatts unit has tripped. This is actual frequency profile. You can see here, for 1000 megawatt trip, etc., the change in frequency is 0.225. Therefore, the system number is 4500 megawatts per hertz. That was in 2011, and that was before South was interconnected with the rest of India. In 2015, by 2013 or something like that, accident, South was actually interconnected with rest of India. And then 2015, Kudamkulam, 1000 megawatt, same, 2 into 500 here, 1000 megawatt unit has tripped. Now you can see here, drop in frequency is 0.13, etc. Now the system number has become 7700 megawatts per hertz. Now, only last month, or some 1 month back, etc., I think Mohan sent me this one. The entire Mundra Tata power plant, 2000 megawatt, it tripped. The change in frequency was 0.18, which he got from WRLDC, etc. Now you can see in 2018, system number has become 11,100. It means that system is becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. Therefore, nowadays even 1,000 megawatt unit tripping, the change in frequency is very less. Now, I will use this concept with a very simple example. This is a 100 megawatt unit, 4% Droop. Now, ignore damping. 1 by R you can D, ignore it. There is no damping. Now, Droop is, for example, when I say what is the definition of Droop setting, 4% means that is when for 100 megawatt load drop, the frequency is 52 hertz. Is that? That is the definition of Droop. 50 into 1.04. 52. Therefore, Droop is 2 hertz per 100 megawatt. That is the Droop, R equivalent. For a 4%. Therefore, my stiffness number is basically 1 by R equivalent, that is 100 megawatts per 2 hertz or 50 megawatts per hertz. Now, if the actual load change is 20, the change in frequency will be 20 by 50, 0.4 hertz it will change. What do you mean? If I am going too fast, you can tell me. Now let's see, I add another 200 megawatt unit in parallel. And both are 4% Droop. There were 100 and 200 megawatt in parallel. The equivalent Droop is given by 1 by R equivalent is 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. This is 2 hertz because both are 4%. For 100 megawatt, this is 2 hertz for 200 megawatt. Yeah? This is a 4% Droop 200 megawatt unit, 4% Droop 100 megawatt unit. Therefore, this will be 100 by 2 plus 200 by 2. Therefore, R equivalent is 2 hertz per 300 megawatt. The stiffness number is 300 megawatts, that is 1 by R equivalent, 150 megawatts per hertz. This was actually previous case 50 megawatts per hertz. Now it is increased to 150 megawatts per hertz. Therefore, if delta P is only 20 megawatts, the change in frequency is 20 by 150.13 hertz. Whereas the same 20 megawatts in the previous case was 0.4, now it is 0.13. Now, I add another 500 megawatt unit. Okay? I'm just going on building it. And I'm slightly changing the Droop to 6%, etc. 6% is rather high, okay. Now, this is 2 hertz for 100 megawatts. This is again 50 into 0.04, 2 hertz per 200 megawatt. This will be 200 megawatt, and this will be 6. There are 50 into 0.06 is 3 hertz per 500 megawatt. Okay, are you with me? Now, 1 by R equivalent is 100 by 2 plus 200 by 2 plus 500 by 3. Therefore, R equivalent you can see is 3 hertz per 950 megawatts. You know, or if I add 200, 300, 800, 2.53 hertz per 800 megawatt. The same thing. My stiffness number is 950 megawatt by 3, 317 megawatts per hertz. Therefore, if delta P is 20 megawatt, the change in frequency will be 20 by 317, 0.06 hertz. Therefore, in one unit, 0.4, if two units, 0.13, if three units, it becomes 0.06 for the same 20 megawatt change. Therefore, that is how the bigger the system, the very small change in frequencies. Now, the same three units, I add actually physically damping. Because normally when the frequency dips, the voltage, the load also comes down. And the typical figure is 2%. That means that for a 1% change in frequency, the load comes down by 2%. Now, units 100, 200 and 500, they are operating in parallel. As found in previous case, it was 3 Hz per 950 megawatt. Therefore, R equivalent is 3 Hz per 950 megawatt. Assume the base load of 600 megawatt. You know, installed is 800, base load of 600. Therefore, load damping is 2%. That is 1% change in frequency, 2% change in load. Therefore, 1% change in frequency is 50 into 0.01. Therefore, 0.5 Hz change is 0.02 into 600, 12 megawatt change. That is the damping. Therefore, damping is 12 megawatts per 0.5 Hz or 24 megawatts per Hz. Are you with me? Are you able to see this? Therefore, my stiffness number, instead of 317, it becomes 317 plus 24. Slightly it has increased. So 341 megawatts per Hz. Without damping, there is only 317. Therefore, load damping increases the stiffness number. Therefore, if I, for example, H, D, normally we ignore D. Is it? If we ignore D, it gives more conservative results. But actually, there will be some damping. Of course, 1 by R equivalent plus D, the first term, that is the governor action, that's a very dominant. Second term, load damping, is a very minor. Of course, in India, of course, this is, we are all taking up this. I think everybody is aware of the CERC regulations. Nowadays, they say that you can't have locked governance. Locked governance means you don't allow the governor to operate. Is it that? That means that your regulation is 100%. It's not allowed to operate. That is the reason why your stiffness number becomes very small. Is the first. Now, because let's say that even if it is, for example, when the Danu gets isolated, this happened in 2008 or 10, I don't know, I think around that time, before 2010, once it happened, etc. Let's say that 250 only Danu unit is working and our grid is connected here. Now you will see here, R equivalent is only 4% of 500, there is 1 Hz per 250 megawatt only. Therefore, even for a 250 megawatt, this one, stiffness number is only 250 megawatts per Hz. And if delta P is 50 megawatt, there is a change. The change in frequency is 0.2 Hz. Whereas we saw that even 1000 megawatt drop, etc., or 2000 megawatt is this full Mundra drop, the change in frequency is only 0.13 Hz. Whereas at 20, here 50 megawatt you get 0.2 Hz. Of course we can see here, integrated grid with free governor, let's say I have a 10,000 megawatt grid, assume average Droop is 5%. Therefore, your R equivalent is 2.5 Hz per 10,000 megawatt or 1 Hz per 4,000 megawatt. Therefore, the stiffness number is 4,000 megawatts per Hz. Therefore, when a 500 megawatt unit trips, it's that the change in frequency is 0.125 Hz. Whereas, if it's a locked governor, instead of 5%, I just increase this to 50%, 10 times. Therefore, 25 Hz per 1000 or 1 Hz per 400 megawatt, for a 500 megawatt unit trip, etc., the change in frequency will be 1.25 Hz. Of course, very absurd. This is actually the crux. For example, you are sitting in this room, you know. I asked Jafar, switch off this light, switch on this light, etc. Just before he switched on the light, the grid did not know that he is going to switch on. is it there? But as soon as he switched on, the light came. Who gave that energy? Isn't it? Etc. Whenever, let's say, a 9 megawatt boiler feed pump, etc. The grid does not know that I am going to start a 9 megawatt boiler feed pump. I just go there, I press a button. The motor starts. How did the 9 megawatt boiler feed pump start? Because at time t is equal to 0 minus, grid did not know that I am going to start it. Therefore, if you switch on any load, instantaneously the system supplies load, whether you like it. Therefore, where does that energy come from? First is, that energy comes from the inertia. Inertia, the rotating masses, etc. That only first thing is that it releases the energy, whatever you want, etc. If the system is big, the effect will not be that much. But if the system is very small, if you throw a very big load, therefore there is a reason why the first one is the borrowed kinetic energy from rotating masses, etc. Now, this is actually the problem which is now coming with, that is the one which causes the initial df by dt. The initial df by dt is basically determined by how much it can release the energy. That is the reason why what they are telling now is that there is a very big problem of renewables. Previously, we have only hydro plants, so you know, we have the thermal plants, etc. Now, if we have, let's say, 50% is only solar, etc. The main problem is solar does not have any inertia. Therefore, renewables becomes inertia-less machines. Therefore, if renewables become more than 25 or 30 or 35%, etc., when Jaffer is asking for some, pressing a button and asking energy, etc., there is no rotating masses, no stored energy, etc. Therefore, there is a reason why for grid stability, now there is some restrictions coming on. What should be the percentage of renewables which you can allow within the grid? Therefore, grid integration of renewable is a very big study in Sigre. And I think that last year, Germany has now banned renewables because simply they could not control the grid. I think that once the energy supplied by the renewables exceeded the energy supplied by the conventional ones. Exceeded. And then they found that they could not control this. Because renewables are becoming inertialess. Whereas that is the one on which I depend. As soon as they switch on, I want the inertia supplied. Okay, that is the first part. The second part is increased generation. As soon as the frequency dips, etc., my governor reacts. It opens the control valves, you open the gate, it increases generation, and then he has asked for another 10 megawatts, it will give you 10 megawatts. And then also, when it goes, the frequency may not settle down to 50 hertz again, but it doesn't matter because when the frequency is less, the load is also, load dumping also comes into play. Therefore, 2 and 3 is, one is turbine effect, another is the load dumping. That's how it settles down to frequency. But this initial df by dt is basically on inertia. First component, borrowed kinetic energy from rotating masses. At time t is equal to 0 plus h, releases the kinetic energy to meet increased load. It's like a withdrawal from the savings account. You know, you get immediately. Of course, the frequency decreases. Initial df by dt as per h of the system. If h is very high, df by dt is low. If h is low, df by dt is high. After a few seconds, system reaches a new steady state value at lower frequency. Okay, unless AGC comes, you cannot. Therefore, but only thing is that stored kinetic energy at lower frequency is also lower. Please remember that, because it is your energy is WR square into RPM whole square, correct? I omega square is the stored energy. When frequency is 50 Hz is operating at 3000 and frequency is 49.8 is operating at some 2980 etc. Therefore, to that extent even the stored energy also is less at lower frequencies. Of course, this is the second component, the governor action. As soon as the load has increased, etc., the governor mechanical power increases corresponding to that, and it settles down at a lower frequency. Third component, release the customer load, load damping. When settling frequency is less, total load also is less. For example, at 50 Hz, if the load is 600 megawatts, if load damping is 2%, 1% change in frequency is 2% change in load. Therefore, 0.5 Hz means 12 megawatt. Therefore, if the settling frequency is 49.5, my load itself becomes 600 minus 12. If the settling frequency is 49, my load itself becomes 576, because it is 1 Hz corresponding to 24 megawatts. This is the dynamic. Now we'll go to, it's a very some 2-3 slides only I got on dynamic stability. Dynamic stability is also called small signal oscillations. You know, very small oscillations coming, but which will actually tear the system apart. Because basically, if you see a synchronous machine, etc., there are two torques. One is synchronizing torque, another is the damping torque. And both should be positive. Both should be positive. To maintain stability, TS and DS should be positive. Now, I think in the first initial lectures, I talked about E1, E2 by X into sine delta. Delta is the steady state stability limit, which is almost 90 degrees, etc. Because you can see here, the synchronizing torque is proportional to a cos delta. When delta is 90 degrees, almost synchronizing torque becomes zero. That's one of the reasons why, of course, I don't want to go into theory, is it? That's one of the reasons why it becomes unstable. And to maintain the stability, one of the things you say is that increase the regulator gain, AVR gain, very high, is it? But if you increase AVR gain, it increases synchronizing torque. Yes, it increases the synchronizing torque. But if AVR gain is increased very high, actually it actually leads to reduction in damping torque. Therefore, you can't have the cake and eat it. Okay? Therefore, you can't indefinitely increase the gain to have a good synchronizing torque. Because synchronizing torque, we said that E1, E2 divided by X. Therefore, by increasing the gain, etc., I am trying to push up E1 and E2. But increase the synchronizing torque, but at the same time, it tends to decrease the damping torque. If the damping torque becomes zero or less than zero, is it, then it becomes an unstable system. For example, if I think that we have seen this one, if no load field voltage is 1 PU, field voltage at full load could be maybe 3 PU. I'm just to tell as an example that the range of field voltage is 2 PU. Now, let's say that whenever you say regulation, that means that whatever I do, etc., it must come back to within plus or minus 5% of what my set value is. Therefore, my settling error should be only 1%, 0.01. Then this exciter gain is given by, say, the range is 2 and the error is only this one, around 200. And then that's the reason why you will just see, you will see that exciter gain, typically what you are putting in your PSSC must be around 70, 100, 200, 300, etc. That depends on what is the range you have got and what is the regulation you want to maintain within plus or minus. Now let's say that I want to have plus or minus 0.01, etc. or 0001, etc. Then if very close regulation, this one very high exciter gain, but if you put very high exciter gain, it may lead to dynamic instability because it reduces the damping curve. That you can even see in your PSS, you can simulate. So 200 you make it 2000. We'll just see the effect. Of course, in these cases only we have the power system stabilizer, which stabilizes the oscillations. It's a supplementary signal to AVR. For example, AVR only takes the terminal voltage and this, but in addition to this, etc., we also have the PSS signal to the AVR circuit. Okay. See, the usual PSS signal is electrical power, usual signal, or speed, but typically PSS electrical power transducers are available, therefore you can feed PSS electrical power output. Is it that? Therefore, this is the only place, you know, I told you in the first class about, you know, that complete decoupled power flow. One is P is proportional to the frequency and Q is proportional to voltage. Therefore, I said that P and V are almost disconnected. But this is the only place in which to control the voltage also, I'm introducing power. Okay, then, of course, this is the only place in which PV loop also I am using, where for controlling the voltage also I have the feedback from the power. Therefore, basically its objective is damping low frequency electromechanical oscillations in power systems. These oscillations essentially due to high speed, high gain excitation systems you use for improving transient stability, because now we have got a static and brushless, we put large gains before, but at the same time, though it increases the synchronizing torque, it reduces the damping torque. Therefore, to improve the damping performance only, we are using power system stabilizers. PSS objective is to provide additional damping torque without affecting synchronizing. That is the reason. Having the cake and eating it. That is, you don't affect the synchronizing torque, at the same time, don't make the damping torque go negative. That is what PSS does. Of course, PSS tuning at site is very important. If not tuned properly, it may do more harm than good. I have seen, when I was in US also, I have seen in many of the places PSS or dabba is kept in a corner. It was not used because people did not know how to use it, etc. There were many times what happens is that you buy PSS, but unless you actually tune it, etc., sometimes it becomes counterproductive to actually commission it without tuning it. You may do more harm than good. Now, there are, I think, only a few slides are remaining. One thing is power system oscillations. If you see in a grid, etc., if you go to WRAB, our, this one you can just see, one is called inter-tier, inter-area oscillation. That means that whole of western grid is oscillating against northern grid, or western grid against the south grid, etc. Therefore, if you see interstate tie lines, etc., when I say oscillations, if you see the power flow, you know, power will go like this, comes like this, etc. And the oscillation frequency is actually very specific, 0.1 to 1 hertz. That means the time period is 1 to 10 seconds. Whereas our conventional 50 hertz is 20 milliseconds, you know, it's a 50 hertz. Whereas here we are talking of oscillations of 0.1 to 1 hertz, very small oscillations. For example, 0.1 to 1 hertz. This is very easy. Of course, say for example, in 1 second, in power frequency, there would have been 50 oscillations. But here, I think this is I think it's almost for your time is 2.5 seconds. Therefore, 0.1 to 1 hertz, that is the very small tie line oscillations. Actually, PSS is tuned, please remember, it's only for this. PSS is tuned only for these oscillations. Or to some extent, I will tell you the next one, this one, 1 to 2 hertz, but this is very rare. This usually PSS is tuned for 0.5 hertz. If anybody doesn't give you any value, 0.3 to 0.5 hertz is the PSS tuned value.
Why it is required? Why are these oscillations are generated?
Which?
These oscillations?
That is basically because of the control systems. Because of you have put some excitation systems whose gains are vastly high, etc., untuned systems. Basically, it is stabilizing the control systems of the ABS circuit. Therefore, you have the huge area here, etc. This will be 0.1 to 1 hertz, etc. This is called intertie of the inter-area mode. Intertie of the inter-area mode. I think mostly WRL-DC actually is monitoring this one. They are not interested in this. Then other thing will be, in this local mode, what happens is that, let's say, entire sasana is there. Entire mudra is there, etc. Or entire Chandrapur. How Chandrapur is now, these units are oscillating against the rest of the grid. That is slightly higher, that is 0.1 to 1 we saw previously. Isn't it? This will be slightly higher. This will be 1 to 2 hertz. 1 to 2 hertz. This also partly is covered by PSS. Partly it is covered by PSS. Basically, these are all control system problems. That is basically because we are using very high gain excitation systems. Now, this is actually inter-plant oscillations. For example, you have 6 units of mudra, 6 units of sasana, etc. How one unit is oscillating with respect to other unit of the plant, etc. Therefore, this is much higher. This is 2 to 3 hertz, etc. This is nothing to do with PSS. This damping is automatically achieved by the damper bars of the machine itself. Machine damping itself achieves this. Amashias of generator windings. Therefore, basically what we are talking about is area, then local mode and inter-machine oscillations. PSS is basically for inter-area and to some extent local mode, but it is not meant for inter-machine oscillations.